Since we've not been able to go eat in a restaurant and we've been forced to go through drive-ins, one of the more challenging things has been getting the right change from a drive-thru. They're even telling us that there's a national coin shortage because of COVID. I'm not sure how a virus affects the coins in my pocket, but they say it does, and so they always want you to pay with a card. When you hand them cash, they look at you like, what am I supposed to do with this? And then there's always that awkward moment of trying to see whether the 15 to 17-year-old in the window can actually make change or not. And that doesn't even begin to talk about the challenge of getting the right change back to you with gloves and a tray and all of that, and a gust of wind comes by and all of a sudden, you know, everything dumps and the coins go on the ground outside your car, the dollar bills that come back and change go flying down through the parking lot, and you have that moment of trying to decide just how important is it for me to get my change. Change, for many of us, can be seen as a nuisance. That's why now you see so many of them asking, do you want to round that up for some various organization or charity? And yet, somehow in the middle of all of that, we have to decide what is it that we value most. So what made Jesus mad? What did he value most? Well, you see, what made him the most angry was when God's people valued rules over relationships. How do you respond to rules and red tape? Some people thrive and comply. Those are basically your bureaucrats in Washington or in your local school district or even at your local drive-thru. Others just bristle and snarl in defiance. Well, sorry, that's kind of me. You know, when you just want the right change from what you've ordered. An overabundance of rules, though, either creates rebellion or self-righteousness. Jesus dealt with both types of people on a regular basis. Mark 3 is the case where Jesus is walking past a field of grain with his disciples, and as they pass by that way, they just kind of reach out and they grab a handful of grain to munch on, kind of like we would munch on sunflower seeds or something like that. It just so happens to be on the Sabbath when the rules were essentially stop, cease, rest, just enjoy. Don't do anything. Now, the intention of the Sabbath was to remind people that our Creator God has life under control, not us. We don't have to go pedal to the metal every day, all day long. And so, to teach us that, He wants to give us a time to reconnect with God. The problem with that is this. We typically turn God's good gifts into something that becomes a burden not only for us, but also for others around us. In Jesus' day, there were religious referees. I mean, they didn't wear stripes and have a whistle and a ball hat, but they did have phylacteries on their forehead and long robes with tassels, and they bragged about how much they knew or how much they had memorized of Scripture and how well they were able to interpret every little nuance of the commandments of God. They were called Pharisees. Jesus was constantly breaking their expectations, their regulations, their rules and orders. And it drove them absolutely nuts. So much so that when they got together, you could almost imagine that somebody said, he's either got to comply or he's got to die. Well, that's pretty much how that played out. When the Pharisees saw Jesus and his disciples just grabbing a handful of grain to munch on, they said, you can't do that. That's harvesting on the Sabbath. And on the Sabbath, you're not allowed to work. It was considered to be a violation of their rules governing their religion. Of course, anybody with common sense can tell the difference between harvesting and snacking on a handful of grain. But that's the problem. When we focus on the rules instead of the relationship, we tend to lose all common sense. Let me share this with you. In Mark chapter 2, verse 27 and 28, in the New Living Translation, here was Jesus' response. He says to them, "The Sabbath was made to meet the needs of people, not for people to meet the requirements of the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even over the Sabbath. That's essentially Jesus telling these referees of religion called Pharisees, you don't get to define what I designed. They had overregulated what a right relationship with God should look like in their mind, to the point that actually having a relationship with God was lost in the process. And that's what made Jesus mad, because God values relationships over our rules. Philip Yancey researched their warped values for his book, The Jesus I Never Knew, and he made this observation in that book. Pharisees and teachers of the law competed with one another in their strictness. They had atomized God's law into 613 different rules and then bolstered them with 1,521 regulations. For example, to avoid breaking the third commandment, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord, they refused to even pronounce God's name. To avoid sexual temptation, they had the practice of lowering their head and not even looking at women. And the most scrupulous of these were usually referred to as the bleeding Pharisees because they would frequently collide with walls or each other. To avoid defiling the Sabbath, they would outline 39 different activities that might possibly be construed as work, such as just reaching out and grabbing a handful of snack along the way. The Mishnah was a compilation of both the actual commandments from God as well as all of their different idiosyncrasies and interpretations of that law. It became practically impossible to go through a day and not violate either God's will or the Pharisees' regulations. Some referee of religion would be blowing a whistle or throwing a flag or holding up a yellow card or a red card to you all day long. They were accusing Jesus of breaking their manufactured expectations of the Sabbath. And Jesus' response, you might say, you're not the boss of me. Or you don't have the right to mandate or alter my expectations of my Sabbath. If you find yourself like they did, cheering when Jesus got whistled for a foul, you're probably cheering for the wrong team. As Bill Engvall might say, or not Bill Engvall, but Jeff Foxworthy, here's your sign. That's what happened almost every time the Scriptures tell a story of Jesus on the Sabbath. Anytime a story starts with one day on the Sabbath, or once on the Sabbath Jesus was teaching, almost without exception, you know that what follows is Jesus is going to do something to yank on those Pharisees' chain or to rip that whistle right out of their mouth. That's the backstory of today's passage, and it starts in Mark chapter 3. In the first couple of verses there, it says that Jesus went into the synagogue again and noticed a man with a deformed hand. Now, since it was the Sabbath, Jesus' enemies watched him closely. If he healed the man's hand, then they planned to accuse him of working on the Sabbath. Here's a pretty good indicator of how messed up what they valued most had become. Now catch this. They accepted as a fact that Jesus could actually help this guy. They accepted as a fact that he might actually help this guy by healing his deformed hand. And instead of being on the edge of their seat in anticipation and excitement that this man's life is about to change, they're excited because they're going to blow the whistle on Jesus for breaking another one of their rules. In verse 3 and 4, Jesus said to the man with the deformed hand, "Come up here and stand in front of everyone." And then he turned to his critics and he asked them, "Does the law permit good deeds on the Sabbath? Or is it a day for doing evil? Is this a day to save life or to destroy life?" But they wouldn't answer him. The traditional story about this man is that he was a stonemason. He was used to working with his hands. But how could he do that if he didn't have full use of his hands? Now, whether it was just because of arthritis or whether it was because of some crushing injury on the job, his ability to provide for his own family had been severely limited and perhaps was even non-existent because of his condition. So when Jesus calls him forward to stand before everyone in their synagogue, now remember, it's their synagogue. It's not the temple in Jerusalem. This is their small farming community because there were grain fields around them, right? In their small village, in the synagogue that they met in that small location, he had him stand up in front of everyone that was there. He wanted to remind them that this was a person, not just a theological debate. He was a member of their community. He was their friend. He'd stood up in their weddings. He'd maybe even been a member of their family. And Jesus wanted them to reconnect visually and emotionally with the individual, instead of allowing themselves to stay disconnected over such a controversial issue in their mind. What is it that made Jesus mad? When God's people valued their rules over the relationship. But that doesn't just happen in a Jewish synagogue over 2,000 years ago, does it? We get just as easily desensitized and only see things as a problem instead of seeing people like, it's just another Chicago shooting. It's just another positive COVID case. It's just another riot in Portland. It's just another number. It's easy for even us to get desensitized when we dehumanize the problem. They no longer saw the person. They saw a potential violation. They saw an opportunity to throw the flag on Jesus and cry foul instead of thanking God for the blessing of being healed for this guy. God's original commandment about the Sabbath had made allowances for saving life. Luke would refer to it in Luke 14. He says, if your ox falls into a well on the Sabbath, will you not pull him out quickly? You see, God believes that life matters more than rules. And no, he did not indicate a particular color of life. Jesus just indicated life matters more. Now, regardless of how much work it takes, and trust me, I grew up around animals. Trying to get them up when they're down is not something that's easy to do. And they didn't have tractors back then. You have to get down, you have to put your shoulder into it, you have to grab a hold, you have to pull and tug, you have to do everything you can, and you're going to break a sweat and you're going to get dirty. That's just the way it is. But it didn't really matter how much work it was. Jesus understood that the life of that animal was worth it. Don't let it die. And if that applied to an animal, then how much more should it apply to a person? Life matters more than the rules. But if we value rules over relationship, then we actually reverse the blessing that God intended. For example, in the first part of verse 5, when this happened, it says, Jesus was angry as he looked at the people. And he felt very sad because they were so stubborn. Now, here's a general principle of truth. Godly anger is always mixed with godly grief. It broke his heart. Yes, it made him mad, but it broke his heart. But also, godly anger always takes godly action. In verse 5 and 6 going on, it says that he said to the man, hold out your hand. And so the man held out his hand, and it was restored. At once, the Pharisees went away and met with the supporters of Herod to plot how to kill Jesus. Either he's got to comply or Jesus has got to die. Luke adds his own observation about how they reacted with this in verse 6. The enemies of Jesus were wild with rage, and they began to discuss what to do with him. There's a couple of different versions of that. The easy-to-read version says, they were so mad they couldn't think straight. The New English Translation phrases that they were filled with mindless rage. And the American Standard Version says they were filled with madness. As is typically the case, when you're that mad, you can't think straight. Because you just obsess about things to the point where even really dumb ideas sound like brilliant solutions. And as in this case, they turn to politicians to solve their problem. Ungodly anger will always lead us to ungodly actions. It was no longer about a man and his family from their own community who had been helped. It certainly wasn't about honoring God on the Sabbath. And at this point, it was about one thing and one thing only: their own pride. Author Tim Harlow makes the observation just to clarify this. He says, so let me get this straight. You can't heal on the Sabbath, but it's okay to plot murder. That's how pride's obsession with control can mess up common sense values. And that's what made Jesus so mad. God's people forgot that relationships were of a higher value than rules. They lost their ever-loving mind when Jesus didn't clear this with the temple compliance department first. They lost their mind when Jesus didn't fill out the right forms and pay for a permit first. And Jesus didn't even do an environmental impact study on what happens if this stonemason is able to go back to work. It might set off some kind of imbalance in the ecosystem. And worst of all, Jesus is acting like he's the one who makes the rules about the Sabbath and not them. It just makes you wonder, doesn't it? If Jesus were living today, who would kick him out of where? You see, Jesus was at a wedding where there was a lot of drinking. You can only imagine what would happen if social media got a hold of that. Jesus pointed out the corruption of politicians and lawyers during his day. Which political party did he associate with? Or would he condemn both of them for their corruption? If Jesus was asked to lecture at a major university today, how long do you think it would take for some snowflake students to demand his resignation because of his culturally insensitive speech and teachings? In all likelihood, unfortunately, churches would be some of the places where Jesus would be the least welcome. Abraham Lincoln, of all people, refused to join a church for just that reason. And he told us why. When any church will inscribe over its altar as its sole qualification for membership the Savior's condensed statement of the substance of both law and gospel, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and love thy neighbor as thyself, he says, that church I will join with all of my heart and all of my soul. Apparently, President Lincoln observed that churches of his day had forgotten the common sense values of love God and love people. October will mark the beginning of 44 years in full-time ministry for me. Apparently, that's somewhat unusual since studies by George Barna Institute and the Fuller Theological Seminary now indicate that nearly 1,700, that's 1,700 pastors per month, will leave the ministry. And that's not just a projection, that's a review of what happened last year in 2019. Only 1 in 10 will spend their entire career in ministry. 90% will walk away from being a pastor. It was near the end of his ministry when Jesus exposed their emphasis on rules instead of relationship. It must have gotten to him too, because he would just rant throughout the whole chapter of Matthew 23 about what hypocrisy they had been consumed with. It's summarized in verse 13 when he says, what sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees? He might as well have said, you referees, right? You hypocrites, for you shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's face. You won't go in yourselves, and you don't let others enter either. You see, that's what made Jesus so mad, that their religious leaders valued rules over relationships, and because of that, not only were they not entering into the kingdom of heaven, they didn't really even care whether anybody else did or not either. Their obsession was to control people with rules and to blow the whistle and condemn them if they ever crossed one of the lines. They were consumed with building up the very barriers that Jesus came to tear down. Where is it that Jesus will lead you as you follow Him? You'll find that He'll lead you wherever there are people who are lost without Him. So that begs the question, will you follow Him into the world of red tape and regulations? That's where people need to know love. Will you follow Him into the world of social media? Because that's where walls of hate need to be torn down. Will you follow Him into the world of the resentful? That's where you'll find people who've been abused by the demands and expectations of others. Will you follow Him into the world of the rejected? For that's where people need the most hope. You see, it's impossible to follow Jesus and not end up surrounded by people who are lost, by people who are broken. His light shines brightest where their night is darkest. And that's what drew them to Jesus. Then that's what will draw them to us as we try our best to follow Him as well. Jesus did not come so that the found people could quarantine themselves away from the lost people. That's what the religious referees were doing. They were making it more difficult to become one of them by building up more walls with brick after brick after brick of barriers and regulations and rules, because that's what made them feel special. Have you received His grace? Then follow Him in extending it to others. There's not a person around you that's more sinful than you are. There's not a person around you that needs Jesus more desperately than you did. And there's not a person that you'll encounter today or this week that will be more lost than you were before you came with your life to Jesus. Philip Yancey, the author, made this observation: before God, we all stand on level ground. Murderers and temper throwers, adulterers and lusters, thieves and coveters, we're all desperate, and that is in the fact the only state appropriate to a human being who wants to know God. For having fallen from the absolute ideal, we have nowhere to land but in the safety net of absolute grace. Paul, by inspiration, would say it this way in Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 21. God has a way to make people right, and it has nothing to do with keeping the requirements of the law. We were made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. He does this for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. For we've all sinned and fall short of God's glorious standard. But God treats us better than we deserve when He sets us free from the penalty of our sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed His life and shed His blood to pay for our sins. So why did Jesus get mad? It was because He valued relationship over rules. So the question I want to leave you with is this: what do you value more? What do you value more than a relationship with God? What do you value more than a relationship with God made possible by the sacrifice of Jesus? Are you praying each day? Not because there's a referee standing with a whistle ready to blow the whistle on you if you don't. Or is it because you value a relationship with God enough to talk to Him and turn to Him each day? Are you looking at His Word each day, not just so you can get a gold star for being a daily Bible reader, or to keep the religious referees off of your back? Are you looking at His Word each day because you value the guidance that He offers you? Are you allowing Him to push you and change you in your values? Are you allowing Him to speak through you to those who need to hear God's message and God's love? Are you allowing Him to work through you to give you hope and to give His hope to others? Maybe you need to make some changes in the direction of your life. The Bible calls that repentance. Have you expressed your commitment to be united with Christ and His values? That expression of faith and commitment is called baptism. Are you more aware of your conscience than ever, bringing your values and lifestyle more directly into alignment with God's? That's His Spirit convicting you, teaching you, guiding you, and leading you to grow more like Jesus. And that's why we make it a priority to learn more about Jesus, so that we could love more like Jesus. And as a result, that we would look more like Jesus in the way we live. For it's our conviction that that's the only way to value His relationship in our life. God bless you this week.